I was in communication with Pastor Kevin yesterday, and his description of his feeling at the moment is, feels like he got hit by a bus. Followed by, but it wouldn't have been too bad to wake up with Jesus. So rejoice that he's okay. This in the first service, Karen was sitting about eight rows back, and I didn't realize it, and I'm going along, and all of a sudden it hit me. I was like, oh, she's here. And I stopped and I said, hi, Karen. I think half the congregation had no idea who I was talking to. And I almost broke down. And as you know, just like acknowledge a distraction in the room, teachers, you get that? Okay, so I won't have to do that a second time. But some of us today, maybe life this week, you felt like you got hit by a bus. And so we're going to go to the Word of God. Let's have a word of prayer and trust the Lord to give us his strength. Father, we thank you that it's in you we can trust. Thank you for the songs that we've sung that remind us that it's Christ alone. And as we look at your word, we'll be reminded of the same thing again. That's in Christ alone we find all we need. Thank you, Lord, that you have protected and preserved Kevin and Karen. Trust your healing hand continues to be upon them. Open our eyes to hear from your word this morning. In your name we pray. Amen. These gentlemen have Bibles. If you don't have one with you, we're going to be opening it and reading together. So love to share this with you. You may borrow it. If you don't have one, you can take it. Be our gift to you this morning. We believe that the Word of God changes lives. I'm going to invite you to take out a pen, and on one of the pieces of paper you have, I want you to write down three things. If you don't have enough time, only write down two. If you don't have time for that, write down one. Think of something that you need, something that you want, something you wish you had or could do that you think would make your life better. Something you need, something you want, something you wish you had that if you had it or could do it, it would make your life better. Write down three if you got time. If you only got time for one, write down one. Tuck it away. I'll try to remember to bring it out later. I want to start with a story. It's an inmate story. Our ministry places chaplains in jails and prisons around the world. And so we talk about inmates a lot. This one is from the Big Island of Hawaii. We've had chaplains in Hawaii for 39 years. Our chaplain, Mike Sidman, is our chaplain in the Hilo prison. The Big Island of Hawaii, we want to talk about a big Hawaiian. His name's Diamante, 6'6", 375 pounds. That's about double of me, if you're wondering how big that is, in both directions, okay? Biggest inmate chaplain Mike has ever encountered. Diamante was a Muslim, sentenced to 30 years. He's done some bad stuff. And as the chaplain would walk across the yard, every time D, that's what we'll call him, was in the area, he'd yell out, "Hey, you!" Never called him anything else other than, "Hey, you!" And then he'd physically confront the chaplain, intending to start an argument about the fact that the chaplain and the Bible and Christians are all full of lies. The chaplain wasn't interested in a confrontation, and he'd back away, and D would simply move closer. And this would continue day after day. Chaplain realized that the guys from D's section were no longer coming to his Bible study. So he asked around and found out that D had told the guys in his section, go to any study you want, any class you want, but you will not go to the chaplain's Bible study or else. So if you're the chaplain, what are you going to do? So one day, Chaplain Mike is in the yard talking to another inmate sitting on the bench. And one of the conversations that he often has with inmates, kind of an icebreaker, is about you need to do the right thing. You need to go home. Your kids need you. Your wife needs you. And that might lead to a presentation of the gospel. And this particular day, the chaplain was starting this conversation, and here comes D. He didn't want a confrontation with D, so the only thing he thought to do is maybe I'll just start talking louder. So he did. So he starts talking to the inmate, sharing this direction of you need to do the right thing. And then Mike would continue. He would say, because I never knew my dad. Said, my dad was sent to prison at San Quentin when I was 2 years old, spent the rest of his life in prison, and I never met him. So I don't know what it's like to be an inmate. I don't know what it's like to be locked up. I've never been arrested. I've never been locked up. But I know what your kids feel. I know what it's like to be without your daddy. I wish I could say I love you, daddy, just once. So you need to do the right thing. You need to go home. Your wife needs you. Your kids need you. That was the message. This particular conversation, Mike was able to go further into the gospel. And he challenged the inmate. He said, you know, I encourage you to read the book of John. He said, because in that book, you're gonna be introduced to Jesus Christ, and you're going to find out what he did for you. That was the end of the conversation. He turned and looked, and D was gone. A couple days later, walking across the yard, a voice yells out, hey, chap! It was D. Here he comes. All 6'6", 375 of them on the way. But something was different. He says, hey, chaplain, I want you to know, I gave my life to Jesus. So the chaplain's like, well, hey, you know, how did that happen? When did that happen? And D said, you know, the other day you were talking to that guy. I heard what you said. And for the first time in my life, I understood what my daughter was feeling about me being here. And then you told the guy to read the book of John, so I did. I read it, and I met Jesus. So the chaplain, being familiar with good evangelism, said, well, who led you to Jesus? And D said, I didn't need nobody to lead me to Jesus. I read it for myself, and I met him. He said, chaplain, you know, God gave me an acronym. He showed me what my life was all about. He says, my life has all been about pride. And this is what D said about pride. The acronym pride is people riding into deceitful eternity. People riding into deceitful eternity. D said, you know, that's what got Satan thrown out of heaven. He says, and that's what my life has been about. People riding into deceitful eternity. That's a message from an inmate to you this morning. We're going to look at the book of Colossians this morning. Galatians, Ephesians, Philippians, Colossians, 1st and 2nd Thessalonians, 1st and 2nd Timothy. Continues about 3/4 of the way through the Bible. If you can't find it, table of contents will show you where it is. Years ago, I adopted Colossians as my favorite book. Some people pick a book in the Bible because it's got their favorite story or their favorite character or their favorite verse. We have two gentlemen in Omaha, Nebraska, are supporters of our ministry. One of them loves the book of John because he thinks that's where you'll meet Jesus first. And so he himself has distributed hundreds of thousands of copies of the Gospel of John. He's paid himself to have a million of copies printed. Another of our supporters believes it's Genesis. He says, in Genesis you'll meet God and you'll meet Jesus. And so he distributes the whole Bible and has paid for hundreds of thousands of copies of the Bible to be distributed. So it's kind of like the Hatfields and the McCoys, Bible style, each with their favorite. Why Colossians? Well, maybe it's because it was simple. Colossians to me is very straightforward. It's packed. And I'm going to encourage you this week, maybe this afternoon. You got nothing going on until 6:40 anyways. Maybe you should read the book of Colossians. 4 chapters, but it is jam-packed. You could preach a sermon out of every one of the verses. We're not going to do that, by the way. I only get one Sunday every so often. So we started that, we'd be done by 2099. But simple things. There's a lot of simple things in the book of Colossians. They're basics, and that works for me. Now, when we take a look at a book of the Bible, we need to understand the context. The best way to understand the context is to ask 6 questions. There's 6 faithful friends who taught us all we knew. Nobody in the first service knew what they were. How, where, what, when, why, and who. Okay, rhymes with new. Okay, you got it? All right, so 6 questions to ask. Who's writing? Why are they writing? Who are they writing to? When are they writing? What's the situation? What are they trying to say? So again, Colossians is probably the easiest for me because Paul answers these questions very early on. So it's kind of clear where he's going. And when we understand where we're going, then we'll be able to understand what he's saying a bit more. So Colossians chapter 1, verse 1. Paul, an apostle of Jesus Christ by the will of God, and Timothy, our brother, to the saints and faithful brethren in Christ who are at Colossae, grace to you and peace from God our Father. All right, let's stop. Got a couple answers to questions. Who's writing? Paul. All right, that was pretty easy. He's writing to saints and faithful brethren, and where do they live? Colossae. Very good. Colossae today would be in Turkey. Asia Minor is what we referred to it as. According to history, it's a diverse town, a lot of people from a lot of places. Flip over to chapter 3 real quick. History supports what the scripture says. Chapter 3, verse 11. Paul says, a renewal in which there is no distinction between Greek and Jew, circumcised, uncircumcised, barbarian, Scythian, slave, and freeman, but Christ is all and in all. Paul's just described the composition of the church. There's a whole bunch of people, all different walks of life from all different places, and they're all together. And his point is, it doesn't matter where you've come from, the point is where you're going. Okay? So he's got a pretty diverse crowd. Now, one of the nice things about most of Paul's books is that there is one key verse. So flip back to chapter 1. We're going to look at the key verse. Chapter 1, verse 18. This is the point of his message, the point of his theme. He, that is Jesus Christ, is also head of the body of the church. He is the beginning. He's the firstborn from the dead. And here's the point of why he writes, so that he himself, that is Christ, will come to have first place in everything. Or in some translations, that he will be preeminent. I think the Colossians are a bit like us. We're a diverse crowd. But we get a little distracted. Those of us who know Christ understand who he is. We maybe understand the power that resides within us. And when we've put our faith and trust in him, we have access to this. But the problem is the world says you need something more. You need something else. You need something different. You need something better. You need something that person's got. You need a different experience, or you need a different entertainment or something. We just don't seem to be satisfied with what God has placed in our lives. So if I were to summarize what Paul's going to say to us, it'd be this. I have all that we need, but for some reason, we don't always recognize it. For some reason, I don't always recognize what I have. So Paul's going to go through, particularly in chapter 1, he's going to remind us of what we have, the power of it, the value of it. Because if we lived like we had it, think we'd be a lot different. Specifically, verse 18, so that in all things he, Christ, may have first place in everything or the preeminence. Dr. Jerry Benjamin comes about once a year to visit. He speaks here and then he speaks down the road. And he speaks of preeminence versus prominence almost every time he comes. And he uses it in reference to his wife. He says, if my wife were to be prominent in my life, then she would be one among many, one among equals. However, she is not one among equals. She is not prominent. She is preeminent, meaning she is the one and only one without equal. That's what Paul's saying. Christ should not be just prominent, just an important part of your life. He needs to be the most important alone without equal. And that's the theme of the book. So we could stop there and say, well, there you go. It's pretty simple, isn't it? Just make Christ first. But it's not that easy, is it? So let's go to verse 3 of chapter 1. Chapter 1, verse 3. We give thanks to God, the Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, praying always for you. He says we because it's he and Timothy both writing. Since we heard of your faith in Christ Jesus, the love which you have for all the saints because of the hope laid up for you in heaven, of which you previously heard in the word of truth, the gospel, which has come to you, just as in all the world also, it is constantly bearing fruit, increasing even as it has been doing in you since the day you heard of it and understood the grace of God. Just as you learned it from Epaphras, our beloved fellow bondservant, who is a faithful servant of Christ on our behalf, and he informed us of your love in the Spirit. What we know is that Paul's never actually met these people, but he's heard about them, and Epaphras is the one that planted the church, and so he's heard of their faith, and he's writing to encourage them. Again, verse 3, we give thanks to God, the Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, praying always for you. You'll find prayer continuing throughout this passage. Verse 4, since we heard of your faith in Christ, the love which you have for all the saints and the hope which is laid up for you in heaven. Notice the three things he says you have. We've heard about this. You have faith, you have love, and you have hope. Back in the day, I was the admissions director at Washington Bible College, and I would travel all over the place, primarily talking to high school students about their lives, about their careers, where they're headed in life. And whenever we had an extended conversation, I'd come to this passage, and I would ask them the question, what does everyone in the world need? And I'm not talking about food and water and air. What is it that everybody in the world is seeking to be satisfied? What is it that they need? And ultimately, we could direct the conversation and land right here, that everybody in the world needs faith, something to believe in. They need love to give and receive love, and they need hope, that sense of security. That's what they're after. That's what they're chasing. That's how humans are wired. And so the conversation would continue, and I'd ask, well, where does the world suggest that we place our faith and find love and discover hope? And invariably, we'd narrow it down to three things. Yourself, others, and money. Every time. And I went through this exercise literally hundreds of times, and that's where we ended up. The problem is we're in a fallen world. And as a result, if we're just trying to believe in ourselves and surround ourselves with great people and put our faith in money, it's not going to work. The world says you got to love yourself, you got to let somebody love you. Maybe we could write a song about that. And happiness comes from money. The world says that hope, your destiny is within your control. Surround yourself with good people and prepare your financial future. That's where it's going to be. And here's the problem. You will fail. Hate to be so negative. But if you haven't failed yet, it's going to happen real soon. All right? You know that. We are imperfect people. And the problem with others is they'll do you wrong. Now, I don't mean that everybody's out to get you, but the fact is they're no better than you are. They're no better than I am. So if I'm a failure, they're going to fail too. And the fact of money is money comes and goes. So the problem is if that's where my faith is, I'm going to fail. People will do me wrong. Money's going to come and grow. If that's where all my love is coming from, myself, well, I'm going to fail. Others do me wrong, and money's going to come and go. And if my hope and security rests in me, well, I'm going to fail. Others are going to do me wrong, and money's going to come and go. Kind of depressing. But it's true, isn't it? That's not where we're going to find what we need. You may be trying really, really hard, and you may actually be doing better than others. But the truth is you will fail and fall short because you're a fallen person just like me in a sinful world, and we can't meet our own needs. So Paul is saying, listen, Colossians, here's the deal. You've got what you need. The first thing you have is faith. Faith in Christ, the one who never fails, the one who never has, the one who never will. He's never messed it up. He's not about to do it. He is the object of your faith. And the point isn't how much faith you have, but in the object of your faith. I hate to fix cars. I hate to pay to fix cars. I feel kind of dirty when I do. Forgive me if you're in the industry. That's just the way I just don't like it. I wish they were kind of disposable, right? It'd be easier that way. So I have a particular brand of car I buy, shall remain nameless. But I'm shooting for 250,000 miles minimum. Short of that, it's a failure, right? That's me, right? I don't want to have to fix it. And I actually have a thing. So driving down the road, if I see a car broken down on the side of the road, I say to Ryan, our 13-year-old, Ryan, mark it down. We're not buying that car, right? And if it's burning, if it's on fire, we guarantee we're not buying that car, okay? No way. Not if fire is a possibility. I'm not buying it. Sounds kind of radical, but hey, that's where I am. So one of the cars that we had a couple years ago, you know you're in trouble when all the lights on the dashboard go on, like Christmas tree, right? Some of us have lights, we just ignore them. But when it gets to like all of the lights, you probably have a problem. And then it wasn't shifting properly, but then it fixed itself, miraculously, right? It's like, boom, next day we were fine. I'm thinking, oh, this is good time to trade it in, huh? While the lights are off. So 160,000 miles. So it's a failure car. It hasn't made it. And I say, well, let's go to the dealer, just see what they might offer us and trade. Well, on the way, guess what? Christmas tree lights up. You're like, oh, geez. But hey, it's still shifting. So we get there. They take it for a little test drive. 200 yards from the entrance, guess what? Boom, first gear, won't move, right? 15 miles an hour. Well, we did trade the car that day, and we got a set of floor mats for it. So that was about all we got. Well, point is, your car is not going to last forever. I don't care what brand you buy. No matter how much you believe in it, no matter how much you trust in it, be as committed as you want, be as loyal as you want, my level of effort doesn't matter. What matters is where I'm putting my faith. It's in Christ, the only one I can trust. Never failed, never will. Second thing we have is we have love. We need to give and receive love. That's the nature of people. It's the nature of relationship. You know, when God created Adam, he said it was all good except for one thing. What was that? Not good that man should be alone, right? So wait a minute. Adam had a perfect relationship with his creator, and yet God said there's something wrong. He still needs another human being, and he created Eve for that purpose. That's how we're designed, for a relationship with God and relationship with one another. Relationship with one another is good, but without a relationship to God, it's doomed. Dave Cole and I share an affinity for a particular movie, Princess Bride, that's right. The end of the movie, four people riding off on white horses. It's the man in black, or Wesley, Princess Buttercup, Inigo Montoya, who killed my father. Oh, wait a minute, you killed my father. And Vesig. So they ride off into the sunset, and as they're going, some of you remember, nobody in the first service did, the song that's being sung. Our love is like a storybook story. It's as real as the feeling I feel. We'll stop there because you're all looking at me with this dazed and confused look like I never heard that song in my whole life, right? Here's the problem. Real love is not like a storybook, at least not for longer than about 12 seconds, right? It doesn't work that way. And if we're going around looking for the feeling I feel and thinking that that's love, looking for love in all the wrong places. Hey, there's a song. Someone should write that one. In our ministry, we are exploring a partnership with the American Bible Society. The American Bible Society launched the Trauma Healing Institute, a biblical approach to helping people who've experienced trauma about 7 or 8 years ago, and they'd like to expand it into prisons in the United States, and we have access to more prisons than most organizations, and so they'd like to work with us. 97% of the women behind bars in America have experienced some form of sexual or physical trauma. There's natural trauma in life that's unavoidable, but when trauma is perpetrated by another individual, another human being, it tends to create a very warped perspective in the mind and heart of a victim of what real love is. True love, unconditional love, sacrificial love comes only from the author of love, a God who loved you and loved me so much that he sacrificed himself, his own son, so that we could be restored to a relationship with him. That's real love, and it's only found in Christ. The third thing that they had, the third thing that we have if we're a follower of Christ, is hope. That is not a wishful thing, but the security, the knowledge that everything is under control and ultimately it's going to be okay. The hope that comes from a trust in a sovereign God. Romans 8:28, one of the more popular or famous verses in the Bible. And we know that all things, or God causes all things, depending on your translation, same idea. God causes all things to work together for good for those who love him and are called according to his purpose. Here's the thing, if God was not sovereign, meaning if he didn't hold all the power, then that verse is a lie. Right? Then it's a false claim for someone to say, I can take everything that you got going on and I can turn it into something good. It's a lie unless that person who makes the statement holds all the power. I can promise you anything I want. I can promise you that today is going to be a great day. I can promise you tomorrow is going to be better than today. And I have no ability to assure that that will happen because I have zero power. But God says to those who are called according to his purpose, to those who are followers of him, he can work it all together. And in that we find our hope. Our confidence comes from God. It comes from putting our faith in him. Our love and hope in the eternal God, the all-knowing God, the all-powerful God. Not banking on myself, not banking on other people, not banking on money or the government or your education or your pedigree. You pick it. Not one of those can give me or you what we need. It's only in Christ. So that's what Paul is saying. He says Christ needs to be preeminent, not prominent, preeminent, first place. If you are a child of God, if you are a follower of Christ and the Spirit of God dwells within you, you have what you need. So the follow-on question is, well, why don't I always feel like it, or why doesn't it seem to work that way? Seems a little bit more complicated. I agree with you. So let's continue. Verse 9 of chapter 1. How do I recognize all that I already have? And here's what Paul says. For this reason also, since the day we heard of it, that is your faith, your hope, and your love, we've not ceased to pray for you. And we ask that you may be filled with the knowledge of his will in all spiritual wisdom and understanding, so that you will walk in a manner worthy of the Lord to please him in all respects, bearing fruit in every good work, increasing in the knowledge of God, strengthened with all power according to his glorious might, for the attaining of all steadfastness and patience, joyously giving thanks to the Father who has qualified us to share in the inheritance of the saints in light. Who's Paul talking to? Well, he's talking to spiritual people. Not people who are interested in spiritual things, but people who have the Spirit of God residing within him, that is, true believers and followers of Christ. They're the only ones that are going to understand it. Explain this to someone who knows nothing of Christ, and they'll look at you like you're crazy. They'll go back to you, no, it's me, it's others, and it's money. Paul says, if you're a child of God, you need to understand you've got it. So how do we access it? Well, the key is prayer. And there's three things that Paul invites us to pray for because he's praying for them. So I'm suggesting that if Paul says he's praying for it, that's a pretty good model for us to follow. And here's what he's praying. Pray that they would be filled with the knowledge of God, overflowing with wisdom and understanding. When's the last time you prayed for wisdom? I mean diligently prayed for wisdom. Lord, fill me today with your understanding. Fill me with your wisdom. Help me to see your world, my world, from your perspective. Help me to understand the difference between what's important and what's trivial. Help me to understand the difference between a truth and a lie. Help me to understand what you're trying to teach me through whatever it is I've got, rather than me being angry or bitter or whatever about my circumstances. That's Paul's prayer. So that's prayer number one. Pray for wisdom. Number two, pray for obedience. Verse 10, Paul continues to pray. He says, so that you may walk in a manner worthy of the Lord to please him in all respects, bearing fruit in every good work, increasing in the knowledge of God. So what does God want from us? If we're a child of God, what does he want? He wants us to walk in a worthy manner. That means honorable. Honorably. Pleasing him. Bearing fruit, that is, demonstrating our true relationship with him and increasing in the knowledge of God. You know, trust, love, security in relationships comes through time. It's not established instantly. We gain it over time. So the question I might ask you is, what kind of time is your walk in relationship with God receiving? Praying for obedience. Number three, pray for power. Notice what Paul prays for. He prays that you would be filled, verse 11, strengthened with all power according to his glorious might for the attaining of all steadfastness and patience. Strengthened with all power according to whose might? What does it say? His might. His might. This is not a suck it up, give it your all speech. That would be depending upon ourselves. He says, no, 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 no. You have the power of God resident within you. Let that sink in for a moment. The power of God resides within me. I need to rely upon that power, not my own brain power, not my own understanding, not my own strength. He says, for in that you will find the strength to persevere. Ooh. That's to press on, that's to be steadfast. And the strength to be patient, that is waiting on God. Three prayers. Pray for wisdom, pray for obedience, and pray for power. That you and I can experience the peace of God, knowing that our faith is in His Son, our need for love is coming from Him, and it's flowing out of our walk with Him, and our hope is found in His unchanging eternal plan for us. Take out your little slip of paper if you still have it, haven't lost it yet. Just take a look. Ask yourself the question, is this really what I need? Not judging you. Maybe it is what you need, maybe it's not. But if we're a child of God, all that we need is found in Christ who lives within us. You few minutes, we're going to participate in communion. That's the remembrance of what Christ has done for us in shedding His blood on the cross, paying our penalty for sin. And Christ Himself said, remember this, remember me. Remember the love that I have for you that restored you to this relationship. This communion table, just like the message from Colossians, is for believers only. And what that means is if you're not sure what your relationship with God is today, I suggest you just let the elements pass. The end of the service, prayer and care team will be here. I'll be up here. We'd love to introduce you to Jesus Christ in a very real and personal way, so that you can understand the faith, the hope, and the love that can be found only through Him. Let's pray. Father, it's hard at times to take what we know to be true and do everything that you really want us to do with it. That's our challenge this morning. That we would activate the faith that we have in your Son. That we would embrace the love that you have shown to us. And that we would live with a perspective of eternity, knowing that we have the confidence, if we know you truly, that we will be with you. Grant us the power that we need to fully trust you and rely upon you. For it's in your name we pray. Amen.